Why do all planets orbit in the same plane? We noticed it quite early, we humans. Of what? Well, of the fact that there were fixed stars in the sky, and then other stars that were, however, constantly changing position, always chasing each other along a celestial path that seemed unchanging over the centuries. A path also followed by the moon, and which apparently seemed to follow the sun as well, before it was realized that our star was stationary and that it was the Earth that was turning along with all the other known planets. Basically, the ancient observers were witnessing a strange thing. The fixed stars filled the sky throughout, free to shine wherever they wished, while the wandering stars, i.e. the planets, seemed to be forced to move all within that very thin imaginary band that enveloped the entire celestial sphere. A belt that came to be called the ecliptic, because only along its path could an eclipse occur between the sun and the moon, and with which was immediately associated the so-called zodiac belt, in which the 12 constellations crossed by the planets, sun, and moon were identified. The ecliptic was of great interest to early sky watchers, as it was obviously imbued with meanings related to astrology and divination based on the position of the stars. When the mysticisms of astrology gave way to science, it became clear that there was indeed meaning in the ecliptic, but only of an astronomical nature. It suddenly became clear after Kepler with his laws and then Galileo with his telescopes established once and for all the real nature of the wandering stars, that it could not be an accident that the planets orbited the sun all in the same plane. In fact, what could be expected was that the orbits were randomly oriented, since gravity, the force that keeps the planets in these stable orbits, works the same way in all three dimensions. So it would have been more normal to observe an arrangement more like that of a swarm buzzing around a beehive rather than a nice, orderly series of near-perfect circles. In fact, much more than normal, since someone took the trouble to calculate that the odds of having a solar system with 8 planets orbiting such similar planets are about 1 against 30 billion. That oddity clearly had to depend on something related to the origin of the solar system itself. But from what exactly? The answer to this question is quite complex and involves several important physical concepts that we are about to learn about together. Are you ready for a plunge back in time, billions of years? A long time ago, when the star formation rate of the Milky Way had practically reached its maximum, something very normal for those times, but at the same time very special for us, began to happen in one of its most innermost arms. In fact, what we now consider our celestial condominium was about to take shape, the solar system. A construction that, as we shall see, would not last a day or even a century, but even a decade or so of millions of years. The time it took for our sun to form and began to shine as a reassuring main sequence star. 10 million years on the human timescale may seem like an infinite amount of time, but in fact it represents only 1,000th of the age of the universe at the time. Then again, what we are about to describe are all slow, very slow, albeit immense processes, phenomena in comparison with which are most terrible and earth-shattering earthquakes or the most disastrous tropical hurricanes are in no way comparable. Our tale begins 4.6 billion years ago, amid the faint veils of a cloud orbiting lazily at a distance of 27,000 light-years from the galactic center. It is an immense mass of gas by our standards, extending for 50 or perhaps 100 light-years, although the size represents only 1,000th of the diameter of the entire galaxy. Its density, typically of 100 molecules per cubic centimeter, could rival the most driven vacuum we can get here on Earth today, and its temperature is terribly low, only a few degrees above absolute zero. It may seem strange, but the origin of our solar system lies entirely in this icy cosmic void, floating in darkness for the time being. A scenario so dark that it brings to mind certain passages from Fred Hoyle's novel, The Black Cloud. If not even the words of Genesis, darkness covered the abyss and the Spirit of God hovered over the waters. But this is a video that is mostly about astronomy, so we must clarify right away that the Spirit of God was actually composed of 73% molecular hydrogen and 25% helium, with a remaining 2% carbon, nitrogen, oxygen, and silicon compounds, as indeed were thousands of other nebulae that covered the disk of the galaxy at that time. At a certain moment, however, something disturbed the tranquility of the cloud, and regions with higher densities began to collapse under the pull of gravity, a something that, according to the most accepted theories, may be represented by a close encounter with a massive star, shockwaves triggered by the radiation of nearby newborn stars, or by the expulsion of one or more supernovae. In fact, the cloud is in a state of dynamic equilibrium between the thermal energy of its particles, which tends to disperse them, and the force of gravity, which instead tends to keep them close together. If, due to internal turbulence or an external cause, this equilibrium is broken, with the creation of instability. In some parts of the denser cloud, the force of gravity may prevail over internal pressure and trigger a gravitational collapse, capable of leading to the birth of something very different from a cold cloud of gas. Whatever its origin, in fact, the effect of the perturbation is to fragment and thicken the cloud into hundreds or perhaps thousands of small globules, each about a tenth of a light year in size, more than 100 times the current size of the solar system, and each of which will then give birth to a star. It should be known that stars are not born in solitude, but come into the world in clusters of hundreds of individuals. Hang on a sec, guys, before we continue. Be sure to join the Insane Curiosity channel. Click on the bell, you will help us to make products of even higher quality. Within the globule that interests us most closely, obviously the one in which the sun is forming, gas continues to collapse and the denser region to heat up, while around it a kind of dusty cocoon formed by the material of the primordial cloud not yet involved, atoms, molecules, and dust composed of heavier elements. Slowly the center of the globule begins to compact and show a rotation more and more pronounced. The collapse, in fact, does not occur simultaneously and with the same intensity throughout the cloud. The initial cloud is so large that it admits different falling velocities in its various regions, so that at some point, as in a downward air current, a preferential rotation is formed. As a result, the cloud begins to rotate and crush faster and faster. The phenomena is governed by the important principle of conservation of angular momentum, according to which, in the absence of external forces, angular momentum, that quantity that measures the intensity of a body's rotation about its axis, does not change over time. Are you familiar with an ice skater? The closer her arms are to the body, that is, to its axis of rotation, the more she increases her rotational speed, and her angular momentum remains constant. Thus, although our primordial cloud possessed a very slow initial rotation at first, as the mass becomes more concentrated and the volume decreases, it speeds up its rotation. Because of the centrifugal force then due to the rotation, the matter does not all fall towards the center where the sun is to be ignited, but also spreads all around, forming an accretion disk of at least 100 astronomical units in radius. The latter then fragments into smaller parts, each of which begins to collapse and rotate on itself independently, taking with it some of the overall initial angular momenta. Collapsing and aggregating thus form the so-called planetesimals, solid bodies a few kilometers in size, which in turn give rise to the protoplanets, that is, the protogenitors of the planets we know today. This is the big picture, but there are aspects of the issue that need to be much better defined. For example, when we say that the planets orbit the Sun in an approximately common plane, what do we mean by that approximately? Well, actually, the alignment is not perfect. In absolute terms, the difference between the orbit most inclined is the least inclined is only 6 or 7 degrees, and its exact value depends only on the reference system we use to count those differences. And here we learn that the ecliptic line, besides being entirely imaginary, is also only a convention. The ecliptic plane, in fact, is nothing more than the orbital plane of our planet. And it is from this fictitious plane that we begin to calculate the inclinations of the other orbits. From this, it follows that the inclination of Earth's orbital plane is by definition equal to 0 degrees. Mercury's, consequently, will be 7 degrees, that of Venus, 3.4. Mars, 1.85 degrees. Jupiter, 1.3 degrees. Saturn's, 2.5 degrees. Uranus, 0.77 degrees. And Neptune's, 1.77 degrees. Okay, but these are values we use only for computational convenience, as they do not correspond to a reality based on the physics of planetary formation. Actually, we are talking about a pure convention, as we Earthlings like to be in the center of every unit of measurement and calculation. If we were to calculate the inclinations of the orbital planes on the equatorial plane of the Sun, things would change a lot. In fact, the Sun's axis of rotation is not perpendicular, as one would expect, to the orbital planes of the planets, but is definitely tilted. Until now, no one had advanced a convincing explanation for this deviation. Now, an explanation may come thanks to the hypothetical existence of a large planet that some astronomers believe may orbit tilted 30 degrees, a few hundred astronomical units away from the Sun. Basically, what everyone is calling Planet 9, and which all astronomers have been trying to locate since early 2016, when its existence was hypothesized based on gravitational anomalies observed for objects beyond Pluto, could have acted over billions of years on the arrangement of the orbital planes of other planets. On another note, we were saying that if the inclinations of the orbits were calculated with respect to the equatorial plane of the Sun, then everything would change. Earth's orbital plane would become the most inclined with 7.1 degrees. That of Mercury would be 3.4 degrees. That of Venus, 3.9 degrees. That of Mars, 5.7 degrees. That of Jupiter, 6.1 degrees. Saturn's, 5.5 degrees. Uranus's, 6.5 degrees. And Neptune's, 6.4 degrees. Really strange, isn't it? But of course, all this applies to planets and all other celestial objects formed in accretion disks, such as the large satellites of gas giants, for example, which lie almost perfectly in the plane of rotation of the planet to which they belong. Then there are smaller bodies, such as asteroids and comets, which in the most extreme cases show very high orbital inclinations, or as also the dwarf planets Pluto and Eris, which, although definitely large, move on orbits inclined 17 degrees and 44 degrees respectively. All objects evidently had different births or gravitational fates than their larger siblings.